Thank you for inviting me. I will speak about an approach to periodic Hodge theory that was developed for the last couple of years. And it's somewhat complementary to other three approaches of Foltings, Nisioli, and Tsuji, and we think it's more direct. So for me, the key thing would be a construction of the period map, and I will try to explain first what we want to have. So I will denote, if we have a field F, then I will denote by the sign, the category of varieties over F, which are for me reduced, separated schemes of finite type over F. Okay. Now, if F has characteristic zero, then I can assign, one can assign to any variety X its Durham cohomology. I will denote the complex, the Durham complex, in this manner. And in case when X is smooth, well, this is usual cohomology with coefficient in the Durham complex of differential forms. In case when X is not smooth, you use one uses cohomological descent as was used in Delin in his articles on Hodge theory, and I will remind the construction later. And also, I should say that it's certainly it's a commutative DG algebra, and it carries a canonical filtration, namely the Hodge-Delin filtration. Now, suppose for a moment that we consider our the base field is a field of complex numbers. Then, apart from the Durham cohomology, we can consider just classical, just usual cohomology. So we consider X as the point, complex point of X, it's topological space with classical topology. And then we can consider just cohomology of this topological space with complex coefficients. Oops. Anyone knows that there is that the two complexes of complex vector spaces can be canonically or DG algebras can be canonically identified. So we have the period isomorphism, which morally it is integration of algebraic differential forms along topological cycles. And it can be also defined, the map itself can be also defined in the following manner. Let's consider analytic Durham cohomology. Let's assume for simplicity that X is smooth, otherwise you repeat same words. And then certainly there are two evident maps. So first, algebraic Durham cohomology, it maps to analytic Durham cohomology. And also since constant sheaf sits in the usual manner inside of analytic Durham complex, there is this map. And this map, the second map, is known to be a quasi-isomorphism due to Poincaré lemma. So therefore, in order to define this arrow, not to prove that it's a quasi-isomorphism, but just to define it, it suffices to have such sort of a diagram and to prove Poincaré lemma. So I would like to do the very same thing in the periodic situation. So let me end. The precise assertion was conjectured by Fontaine, and I will consider not the most, well, a little bit more rough situation than one can do, namely the Biderham story. So here is the situation. So for me, K will be periodic field, which is, well, you can take it QP, or if you wish, fractions of bit vectors where K small is a perfect field of characteristic P. And then I will denote by K bar a fixed algebraic closure of K. Well, then, and I will consider varieties over K bar. Okay, so if I have such a variety, then as before, we have Durham cohomology. And also, we have an analog of classical cohomology. This will be a tal QP cohomology. And Fontaine conjectured, and then Fontaine, Yule, and Tsuji in different way proved that there is an analog of the classical period isomorphism. So the story comes as follows. So there is, so first Fontaine defined a field which he denote by Biderham, and it is a field which contains K bar. And it has the following extra structure. This is a discrete discretely valued field, complete. So the ring of integers is denoted by Biderham plus. K bar sits inside, actually, of the ring of integers. And the residue field coincides. So you have a map from the K to the residue field. And the residue field coincides with periodic completion of K bar. And I will denote it by CP. Moreover, inside of M Durham, there is a canonical embedding of the Tate model of roots of periodic roots of unity in K bar inside of M Durham. And we think that and this embedding, well, any generator here becomes a generator in M Durham. So therefore, you can say that Biderham is isomorphic. Well, let me write it as CP to pi I, where 2 pi I is any generator of ZP of 1. Well, any such field is can be written in this manner, except that this isomorphism is not canonical. So you know that you can split. You can embed the residue field inside of the ring, ring of integers, but you cannot do it canonically. And Biderham is defined canonically. In particular, the Galois group of K bar over K acts on Biderham, and there is no such splitting. Okay. Now I can formulate what we are looking for, and this is an identification which will also denote by rho the period map. So we pick any algebraic variety over K bar, and we are looking for a canonical identification over gamma the RAM of X, then we extend the coefficient. So this is a k-bar algebra, but we can extend its coefficients to be the RAM. On the other hand, we have QP cohomology, QP tile cohomology of X. And here we should also extend the coefficients to be the RAM. Now, this period isomorphism should have two properties. So first property is that it should be natural. And natural in particular means that, on the whole picture, the Galois group of k-bar over k acts. So certainly it transforms a little bit varieties, but this thing should be compatible with the action of Galois. And the second property, that it shouldn't be not only a plane quasi-isomorphism, but it should be a filtered quasi-isomorphism. And filtered with respect to the following filtrations. So Bidram carries a natural filtration by the powers of the maximal ideal. Well, the Hodge-Dalin filtration will be denoted always by F. And this filtration also can be denoted by F. Fn equals to n. Here n is any integer. Well, so there, and we equip, then we can equip the left-hand side with a tensor product of two filtrations, Hodge-Dalin one and this filtration Bidram. Here we have trivial filtration on this term, and here that one. And the thing should be a filtered quasi-isomorphism. Now the problem is to construct such an identification. Now let's see a little bit what happens if we replace Bidram by its ring of integer Bidram plus. Certainly here, this thing would be just the zeroth term of the filtration here, because Bidram plus is zeroth term and that has trivial filtration. And to the left, we can consider gamma the RAM of X tensor B the RAM plus. And here certainly this thing will be filtered by filtration. The terms of filtration will be more or equal to zero. Okay? And therefore, since we have compatibility, this thing should go here. But this will not be, usually it will not be a filtered quasi-isomorphism. Not a quasi-isomorphism at all. Now, in particular, you do not have a hope to define a map in the inverse direction. There is no, if you think of Bidram plus being somehow a key object and Bidram is obtained by localization with respect to ZP of 1, then there is no way to map just a tile cohomology the RAM cohomology, and you are forced to seek this map in this direction. Now, the next thing is that you can look at, if you have such a map, then we can consider the quotient, namely what happens on if we pass from Bidram plus to the quotient, its quotient CP. Okay. Still, from the left, we have a map from R gamma the RAM of X tensor CP. But this map, again, it will not be at all a quasi-isomorphism because it kills actually the first term of the Hodge-Dalin filtration. So I will explain the construction so that first I will explain this map. This will be a sort of a model example which will use about one half of the techniques that I need. And then I will explain how to lift this arrow to construct that arrow. Well, and then this thing will be obtained by extending from Biderman plus to Biderman just by linearity. So that will be the plan. Okay, so that's all about the introduction. So again, we will be building the actually this is CP linear map. So I will construct the map from Derham cohomology to Etaya cohomology tensor CP. And then I think that here I don't need to know what Biderham is at all. Okay. Now what things that I need. One basic technical tool will be H topology. Well, H topology is a Grothendieck topology on the category of varieties, which is stronger than Etal topology, and somehow it's the strongest topology which is good for doing algebraic topology. It's bad for descent, so things like coherent sheaves and are not good to consider as local object in this topology, but for algebraic topology it's perfect. So let me remind the definition. So it was introduced by Voevodsky, and one of possible definitions is like this. So you have, if I have a map from Y to X is an H covering, if and only if it satisfies the following condition. Suppose that you have, well, consider a Henselian arrow. So we have a and S. And we have, and suppose that we have a map to a base. Then what we want to have is a lifting, a possibility to lift this map to a finite covering of S. So we have essentially a small disk, one-dimensional disk. We have a map to a base, and we want that after a ramified covering of S, we want to be able to lift in some way to Y. And that's the definition of an H covering. Now, the key theorem here is that certainly this topology is weaker than Etal topology, and therefore there is a map from Etal cohomology of any algebraic variety with some coefficients R, say, to H topology. And there is a theorem which I think it goes back to cohomological descent developed by Deligny in J4 or Derry de Hodge-Trois. Which says that if R is of torsion, then this map is a quasi-isomorphism. So instead of when we play with torsion coefficients, it's irrelevant if we play with the Etal topology or H topology. Now, the next, let me explain why H topology is better for us than Etal. I will deal with this section will called compactified varieties, or they are also called pairs. Okay. There are two settings. One is that I need to consider. One is geometric, and another is arithmetic periodic. So let me consider first a geometric situation. So we have any field F. And for me, a pair would be, which I will denote by u bar. It is the following thing. So we have, it will be, in this way, will be denote, it's rather a triple. It is a algebraic variety u, and it's open embedding with dense image. Into proper variety u bar. But so I want to consider this as a u is a, our key object, the algebraic variety, and u bar is given compactification. And such objects evidently form a category, which I will be denoted by, I don't know, maybe g for geometrically compactified gc over f. And among such pairs, there is a class of the most beautiful ones, namely, let me call it NC pairs. And I will say that a pair is NC pair if U bar is a regular, and the complement to U in U bar is a divisor with normal crossings. And such pairs form a full subcategory here. So that's geometric setting. I will need also a periodic arithmetic setting over K and over K bar. Well, maybe so again, so I have the category of pairs, maybe arithmetic over K, and its object again will be pairs of U U bar. So it's the same as U, an open dense embedding into U bar. But now U bar will be not as before a proper schema over K, but it will be a proper scheme over OK. And this is proper, maybe write also it reduced. K is generic point of the spectrum of OK, so we add the fiber in characteristic P so that the whole thing is proper. Now, inside of all pairs, there again, like here, there sit the best pairs. Let me call it semi-stable pairs. And such a pair is called semi-stable or SS pair if the following holds. So I need three conditions. The first two are the same. So U bar is regular. U bar minus U is normal crossings divisor. And the third condition, it says that the closed fiber is reduced. So I should explain what it means. The closed fiber of U bar is reduced. And this means the following. So let me assume for that U bar actually is connected. So it's connected and regular. And therefore, we can the projection to spectrum of a k factors in Stein manner, so to the spectrum of the functions on u bar, which is a field of integers in a finite extension of k. And then I can consider the closed fiber for the thing, and that's what I mean here. So I consider u bar projects to the spectrum of gamma of u bar, oh, u bar, and that's a closed fiber for this projection. Now the category over k bar. So here the definition is exactly the same, but I consider the ring of integers in k bar. And by definition, a pair over k bar, arithmetic pair over k bar, is semistable if it can be obtained by base change from a semistable pair over in that sense. Now, so we have this various categories of pairs. And there is a natural topology, Grothendieck topology on this category, which I will also call H topology. Namely, let us call a morphism of pairs an H covering. A map of pairs is an H covering if the corresponding maps between non-compactified varieties form an H covering. Well, you can one checks that it's actually a Grothendieck topology. And therefore, we have, and suddenly we have a functor forgetting of compactifications. So we can consider varieties well over something with arbitrary condition. So let's put here some f. So we have this functor. And this functor is evidently continuous, just from the very definition. And there is a theorem which is central for the subject, which is essentially a reformulation of de Jong's theorem, which tells that this functor, whatever index you put here, is actually indices and equivalence of topices. So for us, the most important situation will be semistable pairs over k bar. And the way this theorem will be used is the following. So I will use it to produce sheaves or complexes of sheaves on H topology. Namely, suppose and let me call it H localization. So suppose that you have a pre-sheaf on the category of pairs. Then you can make a sheafified with respect to each topology on this category of pairs. And then due to this theorem, you can view the result as a H-sheaf on the category of varieties. So that is the way the theorem will be used. Okay. The next step, let me remind what the Hodge-Dalin filtration. In this language. Well, so we consider the category of normal of we are in the geometric setting, so we consider the category of pairs with normal crossings. And given such a pair, we can consider the Durham complex of differential forms on U bar with logarithmic singularity along the divisors, the complement to U. Let me denote it as omega with lower index U and U bar over F. So that's the Durham complex. And then we can consider its cohomology. Okay. Now, certainly the thing depends functorially on the pair. So this is a complex of pre-sheaves on this category of pairs with normal crossings. And then we can H-sheafify it. And let's denote the result as A Durham. Well, you can consider Godeman resolution, and then, okay. Well, H-sheafification will be a DG algebra in the category of, well, H-sheaves. And also, it is filtered because this complex carries the stupid filtration. So this is a filtered. And then we can consider for any algebraic variety, we can consider the cohomology of X with coefficient. And this is, by definition, the Durham cohomology of X. Well, now X can have any singularity or whatever, I don't care. And this is, again, a filtered DGA. And the corresponding filtration is, if you look to Dalin's definition, that's exactly the Hodge-Dalin filtration. Okay. So that's the reminder. Well, now I would like to do some. Suppose that my F now is a periodic field, is k-bar. And what I want to play now is to apply this picture instead with semi-stable pairs. And I would want to produce an, so this is an algebra over k-bar, but I want to define an integral structure on it. I want to define an OK bar algebra such that it will produce, after tensoring by Q, it will produce our algebra. Well, you can do it immediately using the Young theorem. So instead of considering geometric pairs with normal crossing, let us consider semistable pairs. So our F now is K bar, and we consider semistable pairs. And to each such pair, well, we can consider now U bar is a scheme over OK bar, and I can consider logarithmic Durham complex over OK bar. And consider its cohomology. Let me denote this logarithmic complex again as omega UU bar, but now it will be over OK bar. OK. It's clear that if I will tensor it by Q, I will get usual complex over the generic fiber over K bar, and I will arrive to the previous story. But let's consider the thing and again apply HFification. It produces you another algebra. Let me call it, I don't know, a Durham flat, say. So it's again a filtered. Again, you have here the stupid filtration, so it produces you a filtration here. It's again an algebra in the category of H sheaves. You know that again that it's, and this is an integral structure on A Durham. And we have the corresponding integral version of the Durham cohomology. Well, I do. It's in E infinity algebra. Strict commutativity have lost, but I don't care much. Let's try. So we have this naive comparison, which is evident. And now let's try to see how actually this algebra differs from that one. Now that this is described. By a theorem of Bhargav-Bhatt. And there is one evident part of the theorem, namely that H0 of the thing, it's certainly just constants. So this is OK bar. But the true thing is that let's truncate the thing and consider all higher cohomology. So we have a map. So you have zero cohomology, that's evident. But now consider higher cohomology. And the claim that this is a filtered quasi-isomorphism. or equivalently due to this identification. This means that if that all higher cohomology of this algebra are actually QP vector spaces that P acts invertibly on them. But zero cohomology is not. That is not very difficult result. It's essentially a combination of the Young's technique and a little bit of geometric class field theory, and also a little bit of neuron model story. I will not explain the proof. Well, now we can pass to the now we can construct the truncated period map. Well, let's call it, I don't know, rho zero. This. Well, consider the embedding. Of zero cohomologies, so we have H sheaf, so we have constant part zero cohomology, and it embeds into this complex. Well, by the theorem, all higher cohomology, these are QP vector spaces. So if I will tensor the thing by Z modulo P power n, then I will get a quasi-isomorphism. Actually, filter quasi-isomorphism, if you wish. Okay. Now, let's apply to this story, to this identification. So let's pick any algebraic variety, and let's apply the functor of cohomology of X to this quasi-isomorphism. Well, when we compute cohomology with coefficient in this story, we get this integral structure under Ram cohomology. And tensoring by Zp power n, it commutes with taking cohomology. And so the left-hand part will be R gamma under Ram hat of x, and then tensored by Z modulo P power. The right-hand part, this is torsion ring. And so it's H cohomology of x with this constant sheaf is the same as a tile cohomology. And so you can write it as R gamma of tile with coefficient Z modulo P power n, if you wish, and take the thing outside. Nice. Now let's pass to projective limit. So I recall that projective limit is left exact functor, so it has derived functor, which is called homotopy projective limit, or just right derived functor with respect to n. So just let's apply to the picture. And now let me, I will use the following convention. If I have a complex of abelian group C, then when I write C completed tensor product with respect to ZP, then this is by definition so a reduced modulo P power n in derived category sense and take projective limit again in derived category sense. So that's convention. And therefore, when I will apply this functor on the left-hand side, there will be just R gamma under Ram let of x tensor head Zp by definition. And now on the right side, well, this is a perfect Z mod P power n complex, so I can pass the projective limit without any problem. And here will be Zp cohomology by definition. And here sits projective limit of this phalloid and this ring of integers in CP. Okay. Now I promised to define rho zero. And rho zero is a composition from, not yet, just a second. Now consider the composition. The map from this complex, it evidently maps to the standard product by ZP. And then let's consider composition with the inverse to this quasi-isomorphism. Now tensor it by Q, or if you wish, invert P. And then the left-hand side will become the Ramp cohomology. And the right-hand side will become a tight QP cohomology tensor CP. And that's exactly this and this is exactly the truncated period map that I promised to define. So essentially, let me sum up the story. So we have this picture with pairs and so on. It produces you an integral structure on the Ramp cohomology. And this integral structure has property that if I take periodic completion of this integral structure, then this periodic completion identifies canonically with ZP cohomology tensor OCP. And this produces you the map as just composition of the story. So that's for truncated story. Again, after periodic completion, we get exactly a tile cohomology, but the map from after tensoring by Q, we get just a small part of the thing. Not the whole, but just a small part, which is quotient model of the first form of the Hodge filtration. Now, how do we recover the whole story? Not truncated map rho zero, but just rho itself. So first, before I do it, I need to introduce an extra tool. And this is derived Ramp cohomology. And nowadays, probably the new generation consider everything in derived sense. But in old times, it was first introduced in Illouzi's thesis. And formally, the picture looks like this. If we have A is a B algebra, then we can consider the Ramp complex of A over B. And on the other hand, we can consider the a resolution of A, simplicial resolution by polynomial algebras. And we can consider the Ramp complex of this thing. Now it has two differentials, simplicial and the Ramp differential. So we consider the total complex. Certainly, since this thing maps to A, this thing will map to the usual complex. And this is, by definition, the derived Ramp complex. It does not depend on the choice of resolution in appropriate sense. And it's denoted in this manner. Okay. Well, actually, this complex carries a natural filtration just by a stupid filtration with respect to omega. And this is called the Hodge filtration on the corresponding complex. And we will consider here only a completion with respect to the Hodge filtration, or if you wish, just the data of successive quotient with respect to the Hodge filtration. This is important because the Ramm complex goes in positive direction and this thing goes in negative. So therefore, each term in principle has infinitely, each component has infinitely many terms. So we have to complete. So let me denote this filtration by F. And then you have similar description in usual situation. Successive quotient are exterior, are I forms. So these are exterior powers or one forms. And here we have exactly the same situation that if I consider Gr, say, M, F of L omega, this is the same as the following thing. If you consider just first forms, then what you get is what is called Katangian complex. And we should consider exterior powers of the Katangian complex, it's lambda M. But exterior powers in derived sense. Well, and then we should shift as in degree. So we have the thing. Well, so I need nothing more from the general situation. And what I would like is to replace everything that we did by derived complexes. And let's see derived Ramm complexes. And the assertion is that everything will go through and will produce exactly the derived Ramm isomorphism. So first, let's look at the point. OK, so the next section, 6. Maybe it's called definition of Bidaram. OK. Well, so we have OK bar over OK. And I want to compute this derived Ramm cohomology. So first, let's just try to see what the usual Ramm cohomology are. The differential forms, they were computed, this, and I will describe now how were computed by Fontaine. And that's a beautiful theorem, and actually very simple. And in order to identify it, let's notice that there is a natural map. So this is OK bar module. And there is a natural map from OK bar to the roots of unity of order P to this thing. And the thing maps F tensor epsilon to F times d log epsilon. So it's OK bar linear map. And this in this space, we can rewrite certainly as writing mu p infinity as quotient of qp twisted by 1 modulus zp twisted of 1. We get that this thing is k bar modulo OK bar twisted by 1. Now, Fontaine's theorem says that this map is surjective, and it's almost an isomorphism. Namely, if we consider the quotient of the thing modulo appropriate fractional ideal, where A is, well, P power 1 divided by p minus 1, something like this, times OK bar. Well, actually, we don't care, just some fractional ideal. Then this map becomes an isomorphism. OK, so that's the description of what forms. Now, the next remark is actually that the derived one forms, the Katangian complex, coincides with usual forms. And that's essentially evident because on each finite level, the ring of integers is, it's complete intersection. So no higher cohomology occurs here. Well, and now we can compute using this formula. We can compute actually all higher differential forms, derived differential forms. Well, so just using this formula, we get that. Maybe let me let us see what happens. So we want to consider exterior power of this group. Certainly, in naive exterior power, it just vanishes. It's nothing because it's p-divisible p-torsion group. But if you consider, let's consider instead of exterior, just tensor powers. But here, certainly, there will be tor 1. And tor 1 is exactly the same group. Well, if tor 1, here should be 2. Similarly, if I will consider higher tensor powers, everything will vanish. If it's m's power, then it will be tor m minus 1. And this will be the same thing, but again twisted by m. Now, higher derived exterior powers, they don't differ much from higher tensor power in this situation. They differ by a factorial. So we get this formula. So let me just write a diagram. So we have functions OK bar. We have one forms that's 10 in degree 1, this K bar modulo A twisted by 1. Now, two forms, they will stand in the RAM complex, they will also stand only in degree 1 because it's tor 1. Classical two forms will stand in degree 2, but because of tor 1, they sit in the same degree. Well, and here you should have 2 factorial power minus 1. So that has to do with exterior power. And so on. When you have m forms, there will be k bar modulo a power m times m factorial power minus 1 and twisted by m. So that's the structure of the Durham complex, of successive quotient of the Durham complex. I don't need it, but just for general information, if you truncate it up to degree m, then the Durham differential will be surjective. There is no first cohomology at all. Good. Well, now we can define B-Durham. Well, I want to define B-Durham plus. But actually, what I will define is B-Durham plus modulo powers of its maximal ideal. So this will be not a discretely valued ring, but truncated ring. Well, say power n, or power n. So we define it as follows. So just consider, so we have this derived Durham complex. Over OK. Consider its quotient modulo n storm of the Hodge filtration. So if I do it, the thing will look like this exactly, yes? So here we'll stand n minus 1. But then I would like to tensor it by Zp in the derived sense. Now you immediately see that tensoring this thing by Zp is the same as periodic completion. And tensoring this by Zp naively, it will produce you nothing. But if you tensor it in the derived sense, there will be tor 1. And the thing will shift, here. And this will be periodic completion of A twisted by 1, periodic completion of A squared twisted by 1, and so on. Now tensor it by Q. And then instead of all the things, there will be just CP. So this is, as a result, the thing is a truncated DVR with residue field CP, passing to the limit by n, we get Biderman plus, and its field of fractions is Biderman. Okay, so that's, so this definition is completely natural, so you have Galois action and everything. And now let's try, let's just, in order to define rho, do I have extra 5 minutes? Okay, so in order to define rho, I should just repeat everything that was said before. But replacing replacing this complex, this cohomology, by derived Durham cohomology with logarithmic singularities over OK. Let us see what will happen. Okay, so we again, we consider semi-stable pairs over k bar, and to each such pair, now we consider the Durham complex over u bar in the derived sense. Well, you can think with log singularities over OK bar. I didn't define over OK, I'm sorry. I did not explain what it means, but probably you can, well, it's not difficult. And you produce, again, applying H localization, we get an algebra. Let me denote it's a Durham nature. Okay. Again, this algebra is before. If you tensor it by Q, you get old A Durham, because all derived things before we pass to completion, they are of torsion, and so tensoring by Q, nothing happens. So that's another integral structure on A Durham. And what we want to do is to consider the corresponding PID completion. And the claim is that PID completion exactly produces you the right-hand side and the period formula. Well, let's call our gamma Durham natural this cohomology with coefficient in this algebra, just repeating everything that was before, and then we should pass to PID completion of the story. And the claim that Pfaadt's theorem again implies that the story coincides with a tile cohomology of X. Well, if we truncated modulo n storm of filtration, we will get exactly cohomology with ZP cohomology tensored by this truncated story, just tensored by ZP. And the reason for this is that if we consider our pair U, U bar, then you can consider it over the story over the point, spectrum k bar. And here you have spectrum of k. So if we look at this arrow, so that is what we were playing with Durham. But this thing actually is logarithmic smooth map. And the corresponding relative forms log singularities, so we considered them actually before. They are perfectly free. And then you can and you know that there are QP vector spaces in all cohomology but the very bottom degree. And therefore, if we are tensoring by ZP, we are essentially just go to our previous story. Okay. And that defines the period map.